Martin Stein sat in his car, impatiently waiting for some movement. He soon heard a metallic sound indicating the release of the hydraulic cylinders holding the ferry doors closed, and then, accompanied by creaking and groaning, he saw a crack in the bow bulkhead in front of him. He watched the bow open and the ramp lower and slide into place, and then he had to wait his turn to slide onto dry ground, followed by a long journey through customs before he could honestly say he was back in England. He drove into the customs control area and rolled down the window, the cold night air hitting him in the face. "Do you have anything to declare?" asked the uniform of a man taking Martin's passport. "I have cigarettes and alcohol," Martin replied, "but I was only in Holland, so I bought them there." "Could you please come over there, Mr. Stein? We would like to inspect your car," the customs officer said, pointing to the empty parking lot. Martin Stein couldn't believe it. He had made this trip many times and had never been stopped before. Annoyed by the inconvenience, grumbling under his breath, he drove up to the indicated place, closed the window, and began to wait. Almost 15 minutes passed, and Martin reflected on the wisdom of using the ferry and the car instead of the faster and easier option of flying. Alcohol and cigarettes, just that. He could make money on alcohol and cigarettes, but if customs confiscated the cargo, it would wipe out his profits for the last 3 months. "Damn," he muttered to himself. "Damn, damn, damn." His self-reproaches were interrupted by a knock on the window. "Mr. Stein, could you please follow me?" said a tall man in a slightly crumpled brown suit. Martin knew this was not a request. He got out of the car, locked it, and followed the man. He was led into a large building, through several corridors and two flights of stairs, before finally being ushered into a room. "Could you wait here a minute, sir?" Again, no question. Martin entered the room. It was furnished with a metal table with a formica top that showed signs of years of use. Two chairs with the same metal base stood on one side and the other of the table. Martin sat on the one that was further from the door and looked at her. Finally, the door opened and the man who had brought him returned. He was carrying a large folder and a laptop case. "Mr. Stein, can I call you Martin?" he said without waiting for an answer. "Great. You have just returned from Holland, haven't you?" Again, without waiting for an answer, he continued. "There you went to Amsterdam, where you met Mr. Eric van der Furth, who was given £2 million worth of diamonds." He looked intently at Martin as he spoke, and the color began to fade from Martin's face at the mention of Amsterdam, his face turning completely ashen at the precise mention of diamonds. Martin was silent, trying to understand what was happening. He knew he was doing something suspicious, always assumed he could say he didn't know he was a courier of illegal diamonds. Although now that it was stated, there could be no doubt. He would have to be stupid not to know what he was carrying. He suspected the first time, and the second time he opened the combination lock on the case he was carrying for the first time. Did it every time after that, mainly to keep himself occupied on long ferry crossings, dreaming of the day when he would have the courage to run away. He put it aside and weighed his current situation. He was not arrested or charged, and the man in the suit did not give his name. Martin knew something was wrong, so he just sat there and waited for the other man to speak again. As the color returned to Martin Stein, Inspector Gray watched him. "Now, Mr. Stein, Martin, I think we can help each other." He looked at Martin, assessing the bewilderment on his face. "As you might have guessed, I'm investigating your employer, and no, before you start looking stupid, I don't mean Charles and Curtis Chiswick, who you work as an accountant for. I mean, of course, Mr. Franco is makeup artist, Mr. Pisgrim himself. The one for whom you carry out assignments, the one to whom your employers hand you over." Martin turned pale again, and his head bowed in defeat. "If, as I assume, you can enlighten me and assist me in my investigation, I am tasked with offering you a way out." Martin raised his head and looked at the inspector and was surprised to see concern on his face. "I am offering you witness protection if you testify on behalf of the Crown." "Yeah, like you did with Derek Bennett. It helped him a lot, didn't it?" Martin blurted out, speaking for the first time since entering the building. "Why don't you just beat me to a pulp?" "We were actually thinking about blowing you up," the policeman suggested. If Martin had looked puzzled before, now his face could only be described as stunned. Of course, if you refuse, we will detain you the next time you go to Amsterdam, or even worse for you, your deputy. Martin physically shuddered at the thought. He knew he was in trouble. If he doesn't say anything, then at best he will be arrested for illegal transportation of goods, and then, when the next cargo is intercepted, rumors will spread that he is an informer. If he goes to Grimm, he'll probably just shut him up, and then when the next guy gets caught, who's going to blame Grimm for his murder? There were two options left: accept their offer or run. It will be difficult to run. He'll have to convince Angie to run away with him. They will need new identities. It could be done. He had done enough for Grimm to know where to buy the documents, but what was the point? Grimm easily finds out his new name from those who provided the documents. Martin sagged in his chair. He had no way out, no salvation. He was deep in the proverbial shit creek without a paddle. Seeing his defeat, the inspector continued. He explained the witness protection procedure, and Martin listened attentively. Martin asked several questions and was disappointed with the answers. He was not sure that everything would go as he was told, but the inspector had an answer to every question he had. Martin then asked a question that changed his perspective on the whole experience. "So where are Angie and I going?" he asked innocently. The inspector looked at him in surprise. "Before I agree, I need to discuss it with her, and we will have to agree on where we will go. I know you said we can't know where we'll go, but I still have to make sure it's right for her." Martin spoke carefully. "You can't be serious. She's the last one who needs to know where you are," Gray exclaimed. Martin looked at him in bewilderment. "You do not know?" asked the inspector. Martin shook his head slowly. "Wait here," Gray said as he left the room. He returned carrying printed sheets of paper and handed them to Martin. "Sign this, and I'll show you something." Martin read the documents carefully, signed one, and returned the other without a signature. "The date is incorrect. By more than 3 months, it is January last year," he explained. The inspector looked annoyed. "Just sign, please." Martin didn't move. "Listen, we have court orders to tap phones and bug almost every home, building, and business Mr. Francois Grimard is associated with. However, everything we learn from these sources shows him as an exemplary citizen. I know he is bribing someone to keep up with the investigation." Martin was silent. "We found out he's using you for more than just bookkeeping, and I just started filling out the paperwork to get a court order to bug your house. That's when I realized I needed another way to get information." His voice dropped to a whisper. "I broke the law, hired a shady private investigator to bug your house from the date on the form. I thought if he didn't know he was being tapped, he might say something. I was right. He practically runs his illegal business from your house and two other stupid women." Martin was both intrigued and frightened by what he heard. "Continue." "I need you to sign this contract. It practically makes everything legal," Gray said, sliding the papers towards him. Martin made no move to sign them. "We, or rather I, learned a lot of things, about Francois, his business, your wife, and of course, about you, Martin." Martin's face turned red. He was both angry and ashamed. Angry about the invasion of his privacy, ashamed because he knew what had happened in the last 6 months in his marriage. "When was the last time you made love to your wife, Martin?" "Looks like you already know," he replied indignantly. "A week ago Monday, the last time I returned from abroad. In fact, this has become the norm for your sex life since we started bugging your home. You have problems. Why do you think this is?" Martin muttered, "She thinks I sleep with prostitutes. Who do you think told her about this?" Martin shrugged and muttered again, "I don't know, some stupid idea that came into her head." "You really don't have a clue, do you?" Gray hit his hand on unsigned documents. "Just sign them." Martin flinched at the sudden noise, but still made no move to sign. "Did your wife sleep with Mr. Francois before you came home, every time you were away?" As the realization of what he had just been told hit Martin, the color drained from his face again, and he bent down and snatched it. Inspector Gray looked at him. He was not disgusted either by him or by the stage. Martin vomited and vomited until there was nothing left in his stomach and his spasms continued. Gray left him to finish and collect his thoughts, returning with a bucket and mop. He cleaned up the mess, then brought wipes and disinfectant and helped Martin clean up. Then he brought a glass of water and duplicate forms. Martin took both, drank some water, and signed the forms. "When should you be home this evening?" Gray asked while doing something on his laptop. Voices were heard from it. Looking at his watch, Martin replied, "In about half an hour." "Here's a live feed from your house. I can only apologize," Gray said as he turned the laptop around and placed it on the table in front of Martin. "You can control the camera using the touchpad and zoom in using the plus and minus buttons." On the screen, Martin recognized his bedroom and its two occupants. One was Francois Grimard, the other was his dear wife Angie. Martin's stomach started to tighten again, but he couldn't take his eyes off the screen. On a different day, with a different subject, Martin would have been impressed by the clarity of the HD image. Today, he felt only disgust. His curiosity replaced disgust and pain. "So, your husband hasn't slept with you in what, almost a year?" Francois' voice sounded through the speaker. "It'll be 8 months next Tuesday," Angie said, giggling. Francois walked away from her and began to get dressed. "I'll send him back to Amsterdam on Friday for a week. I'll make sure he's gone for the whole weekend. I want you to entertain a few of my friends while he's gone." There was no emotion in his voice. Angie didn't answer right away. "But Frankie, what I feel for you is special. I thought you wanted to be the only one with me. That's why you told me to stop sleeping with Martin. I said I want you to entertain my friends." This time there was a threat in his voice. "Anything for you, Frankie, you know that, it's just..." "That's good," he said, laughing as he tied his tie. With these words, he turned and left. Martin noticed that another camera was visible in the small window in the upper left corner of the screen, tracking behind Frankie's exit. It was clear from the expression on his wife's face that she did not like the orders. "I'm very sorry for that," said Inspector Gray. "No man deserves this." Why he added this, he himself did not know. Martin realized that he was trying to support him. "Anything," Martin managed. "Whatever you need, just get me out of here." Gray understood. He felt bad for showing him the truth, but he needed Martin to go against Francois Grimard. Martin was shaking with anger. He loved Angie. He loved him until he saw what happened. Now this love was replaced by hatred, such hatred as he had never experienced before. "First, I need to know that you will be able to go home and carry on as normal, as if nothing happened," Gray said. "After what I just saw, there's no way, but no, I won't mention our little conversation. I won't give anything away. You know your life probably depends on it, don't you?" he stated, then asked. "You won't need to report?" Martin shook his head. "Don't worry about me. Right now, I don't care if I live or die. I only care about one thing, getting revenge on that bastard and that traitor I married." "Well, as long as you can keep it to yourself, you will probably die trying to escape in Holland. You will then be kept under guard until the end of the trial, after which you will be set up for a new life." Martin nodded and asked, "Can I go?" Inspector Gray thought for a moment. "Yes, but you need to come up with a plausible excuse for being late," he said, nodding and leaving the room. "Yeah, I thought a delay at customs would be fine," Martin replied as they left the room. "Yes, such a long stop," he paused for effect. "And yet you went through it with your alcohol and cigarettes," the inspector said, his hint not lost on Martin. Martin stopped. "What? You detained me for 2 hours, ruined my marriage and my life, and now you want to take my rightful goods," he shouted. "It's all for the greater good, I assure you," Gray smiled a predatory smile. The rest of the walk to Martin's car was silent. Martin was shocked to find his car empty, his clothes and other belongings neatly stacked next to the trunk. His contraband was neatly stacked on a cart next to them. "Sorry, it's all for appearance's sake. We don't think you have an escort, but we still can't be sure," Gray explained. Martin picked up his clothes, threw them into the suitcase, and opened the trunk to put them in. "See you soon," the inspector suggested. "Fuck you," Martin replied and got into the car. He didn't even light a cigarette before leaving. "We'll be watching you at home, but we won't be able to be with you everywhere. Good luck," Gray said, trying to show support, knowing that the next week and a half would be very difficult for him. Martin left. He was angry. He was angry at everything. His life, his wife, the delay, Mr. Ter's Frankie, and, as he saw, that thief cop. He didn't pay attention to the speed on the way home. What's the point? He will be dead in 10 days. An hour later, he pulled into his driveway, the usually soothing crunch of gravel under his tires only fueling his anger. He turned off the engine and sat for a few moments, collecting his thoughts, before getting out and getting his suitcase. He locked the car and took a deep breath as he headed inside. "Hey, honey, you're later than I expected." Her voice was cold. Martin looked at her, remembering Gray's instructions to act normal. "I said you're late," she said, her voice taking on the tone of a teacher reporting students. "Yeah, I fucking heard you. Thanks for stating the obvious," he snapped. "I got held up at customs, if you're wondering, and those bastards robbed me." "There's no need to talk to me like that." "Isn't it so? Well, let me tell you, baby, I'm fed up with all this." He was almost shouting now, raising his hand above his head. "I'm tired of this whole journey, damn customs, and, most importantly, I'm tired of all these accusations of you for everything that happens. You constantly accuse me of cheating, so listen and listen carefully. The last prostitute I slept with was you, and it was a damn long time ago. Now what are we having for dinner?" Angie's eyes widened in shock. Martin never yelled at her, never raised his voice, and certainly never swore at her. "There's a salad in the refrigerator." "Another thing I'm tired of," he said as he walked into the kitchen. He abruptly opened the refrigerator door, took out the salad, and, still on the plate, threw it into the trash can. He turned to her. "Now cook me something normal." "I won't," she shouted back. "In fact, I won't do anything for you until you apologize." He hit her. "Now, bitch, make me something to eat or get out of my house now. I said that I'm tired of everything, and one of the things that I'm tired of is your attitude towards me." Still rubbing her cheek, she knew he was serious and began to fuss around, looking into the freezer. She found very little there that could be quickly cooked. "How about bacon and eggs and black pudding?" she sobbed, now frightened by this man. Her husband, who had walked through the door 15 minutes ago, the man she thought she knew, the man she suddenly began to love a little more than before. "Yeah, but no damn salad, okay?" Angie nodded, wiping tears from her wrist. Martin poured himself a large glass of whiskey and returned to the kitchen. Angie was defrosting a package of bacon in water. "Maybe some chips and some fried tomatoes," she asked. "It will be wonderful," he replied, and sat down with the newspaper. "Besides tomatoes, I prefer beans." Angie didn't answer him, trying not to cry. Usually it happened differently. Today she knew it wouldn't be like that, and part of her was glad about it. Part of her liked this new side of Martin. She turned on the fryer, and while it was heating up, she began peeling potatoes for chips. Martin was soon enjoying his breakfast of double fried chips and two thick slices of bread, generously buttered. He loved black pudding and learned how to make it from his father, a butcher. He didn't like mass-produced products, so he still made them himself and had a few regular customers. He bought a gallon of fresh blood about every 5 weeks from his old school friend Graham, who owned a pig farm. "Thank you, honey. This is probably the best meal you've cooked for me in the last 6 months," he said as he put his knife and fork down on his plate. "Now go upstairs and take a shower. It's time for you to start acting like my wife again," he said cheerfully, any sign of anger gone from his voice. He noticed the way her eyes flickered to her purse and the blush on her cheeks. He also noticed that she made no move to take it as she walked away. "I should have done this months ago," he thought, and followed her upstairs 20 minutes later. They had sex. She began to wonder why she had gotten involved with Francois in the first place. Yes, the first few meetings were exciting, breaking the rules, forgery, secrecy, and danger. Yes, danger. It was Francois Grimard's attraction, and she would be a liar if she didn't admit that his blackness added to the experience, but she was a fool. He was too dangerous, and for the first time in almost a year, she realized she had gone too far. What started out as a fling, and at least for her, turned into an affair. A romance that has now doomed her. She was just realizing that she was not only a woman of easy virtue for her lover. He was going to turn her into a real woman of easy behavior. How long, she wondered, before she literally started working outside. As her thoughts returned to what Francois had forced her to do to her husband, she froze, the horror and anger of her actions filling her with shame as she looked at her face in the mirror. She looked at her face in the mirror. Age treated her favorably. She considered herself still beautiful. Now the face that looked at her seemed ugly and depraved to her. Martin left for work, physically satisfied for the first time in almost a year. As he walked out to his car, he remembered that he had to restrain himself. He needed to maintain the appearance of depression that had dominated his thoughts for so long. He had to maintain the appearance of a depressed husband doing everything to build his life. As he drove to work, he thought about what he once had, how it had been ruined by his unfaithful wife, and that cunning, manipulative bastard Francois makeup artist. By the time he arrived at the office, the anger he had felt the night before had returned, giving his face an expression of dejected anger. The weight of his actions for the immediate future weighed heavily on his shoulders. Only those who knew him well could notice the difference. For the rest, he was still the same sad, angry man, slouching, trying to hide from his own insignificance. Shortly before noon, Charles Chiswick asked him a question about the delay at the port. If Martin didn't know what he knew now, he would have wondered why he was interested and how he knew. He still wondered how he knew. Returning to his office, Martin thought about it, as he saw there were several possibilities. The first and most likely is that his beloved wife told her dear Frankie. Second and third, either his car or his home were equipped with electronic surveillance, in addition to those he already knew about. He or his house was bugged, or the damn cop had a mole in his department. His blood ran cold at the last idea. If that was the case, he was practically dead. When this thought came to his mind, it didn't go away. Why didn't he get a number to contact this cop? Damn, I could at least ask the name, he thought to himself. He came up with a few ideas to calm himself down, but the mole idea was one he couldn't resolve. It didn't matter whether it was true or not. Every time the door slammed, every loud noise or voice made Martin flinch. Driving home in the evening, he expected a killer to jump out at every traffic light. He saw a gun in every car passing by. He didn't even feel safe when a police car drove by. He returned home without incident, but was still filled with anxiety as he crossed the threshold and closed the door behind him. For the first time in years, Angie greeted him with passion. "Something smells delicious. What's for dinner?" Why are you? Steak and beer pie, mash, vegetables and gravy. He saw her eyes water before she let go of him and rushed upstairs. Martin also felt a tear forming in himself. He also felt confused. Perhaps she had changed her mind. Did you return to him? Should he try to take her with him on his next and final trip to Europe? He looked up the stairs, thinking about going to her, but the thought of her makeup artist surfaced again, bringing with her the memories of how she had pushed him away, the knowledge of what she had made him do. The food smelled delicious, but he lost his appetite. He walked into the living room, poured himself a whiskey, and turned on the TV. He heard her go back downstairs and start cooking in the kitchen. He sat in front of the television, not so much watching it as having apparent focus. He lit a cigarette and went over in his head what he was told how he should behave at home. Either way, he liked the change, and he also liked the greeting he received. He thought about it until she called him to dinner. He poured himself another whiskey before joining her in the kitchen. One of his favorite dishes that she hadn't cooked for him in at least 2 years, he felt sad as he looked at the food in front of him. He felt angry, realizing that so much time had passed. The discord in their marriage should have begun a long time ago. His taste buds exploded with pleasure as he chewed the first bite. It was better than he remembered, or she had outdone herself. "Everything is okay, dear?" she asked, seeing the discomfort on his face. He finished chewing and swallowed before answering. "Very tasty, darling. It seems like it's been forever since you cooked this for us. Sorry about what happened earlier. I didn't mean to reject you. I was just a little surprised. It's been a long time since you greeted me like this from work." "No, I wasn't surprised. Just caught off guard. Maybe we can try again after dinner." Her face lit up. Again, Martin thought sadly, it had been a long time since he had seen such a smile on her face. This evening reminded him of some of the reasons he had married her. "What did you do today?" he asked her. "Nothing special, a little shopping, cleaning, preparing dinner," she answered. "And that's it? Didn't go to anyone? No one came?" he insisted. "No, oh, I talked to Charlotte on the phone," she said. Yeah, Martin thought Charlotte worked for Grimm. He did not know her official position, but he suspected that she was one of his women of easy virtue. Most, if not all of the women working for him were like that. She probably informed Grimm about his delay. She said her boss Francois Grimard had an opening. I thought maybe I'd apply. She promised to put in a good word for me. Martin's mind worked. On the one hand, he did not want his wife to work for this bastard. On the other hand, she deserved everything that awaits her. But why should this bastard get what he wants? Having made his decision, he spoke, careful not to say anything bad about Grimm that might come back to him. "We don't need you to work. We can handle it. I would prefer that everything remains as it is. You look after the house and me, and I go to work. This satisfies me as a man." Her smile did not fade. If anything, he noticed a fleeting relief on her face. "Charlotte just said that he paid well and that he was a good boss," she explained. "You could stop driving. We could have more time together. We could get our relationship back to what it was." "I doubt it," he growled, losing control for a second. Having restored it, he continued and lied. "I mean, it would take a few months to train someone on the ins and outs of what I do in Europe. Plus, I was waiting for the official announcement, but I might be promoted soon." "Ooh," she screamed, running towards him. "My man, my smart man, let's go upstairs and I will congratulate you properly." He nodded and followed her upstairs to their bedroom. Angie winced when Martin turned off the alarm. He looked at her sleeping body and saw that her sleep was not peaceful. "Okay," he thought, swinging his legs off the bed. He immersed himself in his work, trying to ignore the unwanted thoughts that constantly attacked him. Sometimes he would give up and sit back in his chair, trying to make sense of it all, weighing the pros and cons of his situation. The problem was that he saw very few pros and a huge list of cons. He thought they had a good life, thought she was as devoted to him as he was to her. He loved her, perhaps he still did. He definitely loved the woman he thought he had, but he hated what she had become. He might even consider forgiving her infidelity, especially if a new, improved version of her was what awaited him in the future, but he couldn't forgive her disgusting actions. He hated the disgusting slut she had become for another man. This was not the woman he had fallen in love with, not the one he had married. He felt sick when he remembered what they showed him at customs. He vomited into the trash can. He was still vomiting when Curtis entered his office. "Feeling unwell, Martin?" he asked without any interest. "Did you eat something wrong?" If Martin's face had not been in the bucket, he would have seen the evil grin on his boss's face and realized that he knew about his humiliation. However, the meaning of his comment was not lost on the target of ridicule. Martin began vomiting again, deciding that simply dying was not enough. "Sorry, I don't feel well," Martin said, wondering why he was apologizing. "Excuse me, I'll be back in a minute." Martin left the office, heading to the toilet. He cleaned himself up and, after rinsing his mouth, decided to leave. He would take the rest of the week off. Now he had no reason to worry about keeping his job. He was going to officially die in a week. "Are you feeling better?" asked Curtis when Martin returned to the office. "Not really. I think I'll go home. Perhaps I'll come or call you tomorrow." Curtis didn't answer. He wasn't used to Martin showing any persistence, especially when he felt bad. While he was driving home, Angie tried to break off the relationship with her lover, but she was not very successful. Listen, bitch, you belong to me now. You will do what I say, when I say. If you don't want your hubby to know what you did to me or him. The calmness in his voice unnerved Angie. She was glad that this conversation took place over the phone and not face to face. And don't be stupid, don't try to rush to his mercy and confess, not if you want him to stay healthy. But Frank, I shouldn't have been with you, it was wrong, and it's unbearable that you want to share me with your friends, leave me, she begged. Bitch, I'm not going to sleep with you anymore. Now you work for me, and you will sleep with anyone, whenever I say. His voice remained calm. Now stop whining, or I won't send your weakling husband to Amsterdam and make him watch. Nilu, you can't. Angie stared at the phone after Frankie hung up. If she had previously regretted her involvement, now that she realized what she had gotten herself into, she was horrified for both herself and Martin. When she heard his car drive up to the house, she wanted to die. Martin thought while driving home, he got an idea as he left the office. Now he was working out the details of its implementation. He parked outside the house and sat for a while, going over the final details in his head. He smiled to himself. It was brilliant in its simplicity with only one complexity. If it worked, he was free. If not, he would have to follow the plan laid out by the anonymous policeman. He heard footsteps on the stairs as he inserted the key into the lock. As he entered, he heard the shower start. Did I just miss Frankie's visit? He thought. He was making tea when she came down. He looked at her and asked, Red eyes, were you crying? No, she answered sharply. I got soap in my eyes. Late for a shower, he noted, his voice having an edge that he didn't want to show. I didn't sleep well, overslept, I just got up. Why are you at home? She answered. I threw up, came home sick, he said, looking around the room for signs that she had visitors. Found nothing. I think I'll go lie down for a while. As he spoke, he looked at her reaction, the signs of guilt that she didn't want him to see the recently used bed. He saw both guilt and fear, some more of the love he once felt slipped from his heart. He was pleased to find that although the bed was unmade, there was no sign of fresh infidelity. He straightened the blanket and lay down on it. He lay there for an hour or so, trying to solve the only difficulty in his plan. It was all simple as long as he didn't have an escort, as the policeman called it. Try as he might, he could not find a way around it. The only thing he could think of required a change from his usual routine, and he had a suitable excuse. He clapped his hands in joy and jumped out of bed, pulling out two suitcases and starting to pack his things. After closing the second suitcase, he went down to his wife. He saw that she was crying again. You were crying, dear. It was because I treated you roughly last night, wasn't it? Grateful for the excuse provided, she agreed. I think we need to go away for a few days, he told her. Try to understand ourselves. We seem to be doing everything wrong when I want you. You don't want me and vice versa. I hope that after a short break, we will be in harmony again. Her eyes lit up for a second, then the fear returned. L, for how long? I'll call Charles in a minute. If he says no, then we'll leave tomorrow night as soon as I get back and be back late Sunday, or I can call and say I'm sick tomorrow and we can leave right now, but if he'll say yes, I'll try to take the whole next week. He gave her a couple of seconds to process his words. So it's up to you to decide whether we take the guaranteed 3 days or risk it to get the whole 10 days, which may only end up being 2. She knew it wouldn't be 10 days, 7 at the most, but the thought of avoiding the possibility of Frank fucking Grimard showing up on her doorstep demanding that she sleep with him or someone else was for her. Her too attractive. Yes, oh yes, please, where are we going? Let's decide when we know how much time I have. He smiled. I made tea earlier. I don't think it's drinkable yet. I'll make a fresh one, she offered, reaching for the kettle. Over a cup of tea, they talked, discussing possible travel destinations and what they would like to do or see, both remembering how it used to be between them, both hiding their secrets and their plans. Martin waited until 4:30 before calling Charles Kizik. Hello, Charles. This is Martin. Curtis said you went home sick. Are you feeling better? A little bit, still feeling unwell. I think it's better to take tomorrow off, but I was wondering if I could take next week off. Angie and I have been talking, and we would like to get away for a few days. That will do. Let me check with Curtis to make sure he doesn't have any plans for you. Martin heard a muffled conversation. Presumably Charles covered the microphone. After a couple of minutes, Charles spoke again. We need you back at the end of next week, so I'll see you on Thursday. Goodbye. Martin was never used to the way both Charles and Curtis ended calls, simply saying goodbye and hanging up without giving the other person a chance to answer. Martin turned to Angie. We'll be back on Wednesday. Angie put on a smile. She hoped that she would find a way out of her situation. I guess this means you'll be going to Europe again, she suggested. He didn't say, he replied, both knowing it didn't need to be said. Martin carried the suitcases out of the bedroom and put them in the trunk. I didn't know that you had already packed. Do you want to leave right away? Angie asked. Ready when you are, he replied. I'm just going to the toilet. As soon as she was out of sight, he looked into her purse. He took out her phone and kicked it under the chair, closing her purse and carrying it out to the car. On his way back inside, he met her at the door. Have you seen my purse? She asked. Yes, I just put it in the car. Let's get started properly, he said. Martin loved to drive and was one of those people who kept a map in his head. Perhaps these were numbers, he also kept them in his head. They made their way northwest until they connected with A1 Stretford. From there, they headed north for another couple of hours before finding a hotel for the night. Conversation was rare, both were thinking about their situations. Angie could only think about how to get out of her situation, hoping her husband wouldn't find out. Over the past few days, she had either remembered her love for him or fallen in love with him again. Martin had his own thoughts. He still more was angry at her for the betrayal and outright disrespect she had shown him, and he needed to get back at her. However, he did not want the woman he loved to be used as a prostitute for the man he now hated. Next stop should have been Rislin Chapel, a place they visited many years ago, before Dan Brown made it famous. They agreed it looked better with the roof restored and the protective covering that made it look like a Dutch barn was gone. Later that afternoon, they headed to Edinburgh. Martin didn't pay attention when caught the fire oil warning indicator. They stayed at a hotel in Edinburgh, had a very late lunch, and then continued their sightseeing. They visited the castle and ghost tour before having a late dinner at the hotel. Martin tasted many types of single malt and double malt whiskey, so much so that Angie had to call for help to get him to the room. They barely made it in time to leave by 10:30, and Martin insisted on another walk around the city. She thought it was to sober up, but he had other plans. They were walking and Angie was looking at the work in the window of an expensive beauty salon. Martin told her to come in and see if they could accommodate her. It turned out that they could. While she was getting her hair done, he walked into a local bank branch and withdrew a large sum. He also paid for the month's accommodation he had agreed on the day before. He bought himself a scotch pie and a bottle of soda before meeting Angie. Having taken the car, they again headed on north. Martin continued to ignore the oil warning light, and when Angie noticed the engine was making noise, he assured her that everything was fine. They were almost to exit 2 on the M90 when the engine howled and died, releasing a cloud of black, smoking oil. Only then did Angie realize she didn't have a phone. Martin called a tow truck while they waited for rescue. Angie complained that she didn't answer the phone. But it's always in your purse. Are you sure you haven't lost it somewhere? Besides, I have mine. You can use it if you want, he replied. I don't think there will be much signal where we're going. She had nothing to say. She didn't really need her phone. The only time she used it was to talk to her friends, and when she was told to get ready because Frank was on his way. The tow truck arrived, and the driver informed them that the engine was dry, without oil, and seized. Martin was silently impressed that it lasted this long after he tweaked it the first night. It doesn't matter, it's a company car, he assured her as they were taken to a suitable location for repairs. We'll rent a car and get reimbursed when we return. Less than 4 hours later, they were back on the M90 Inn, a nearly new Toyota Auris. After another 3 hours, they stopped at a small farm, seeing no other signs of civilization. They didn't see any other houses for more than half an hour, while Martin drove the car through the maze of roads. "Where are we?" she asked. "Somewhere in the middle of the Grampians, at least 20 miles from the nearest settlement," he said, walking around the house and finding a pile of dried peat. "Yeah, here it is," he said. "What?" "The key is, you have to love how safe they feel here," he said with a smile. "You planned this without telling me how." He didn't answer her. They explored the house, finding it adequately furnished, but still Spartan in places. They were amazed at the thickness of the stone walls. They found the pantry, refrigerator, and freezer well stocked, enough for two people to last a month. In a secluded place, besides walking and stargazing, there was little to do except relearn each other's bodies. Over the next few days, that's exactly what they did, make love. The reminder Martin set on his phone told him it was Wednesday morning. Turning off the signal, he swallowed. It's time for confrontation, time to tell her that he knows everything. He made tea and took it to the bedroom where she was lying. "Awa, honey, thank you," she purred. "Angie, I need to tell you something," he blurted out as she looked at him. Seeing the discomfort on his face, she asked, "What's wrong, honey?" "I know, Angie," he replied. "You know what, honey?" she asked, feeling fear in her soul. "That's it, Angie, that's it. What were you doing with that damn bastard, and what did he have planned for you this weekend?" His voice began to tremble. "And what's worse is what you did to me. Oh God, I'm so sorry. I tried to break things off with him, but he said he wanted me to." She curled up on the bed and cried. "I'll leave you here. He won't be able to find you. You have enough food. I'll be back after the weekend, maybe in a few days." "At this time," he said, "you need to make a decision whether you want to stay married to me or not. While I'm gone, write a full confession. I want to know why, what, and when. I'll read it when I come to pick you up, and then I'll decide if I want to stay with you." He turned to leave. Approaching the door, he said sharply, "Don't try to go anywhere. You will get lost and die. Goodbye." Martin got up and left, leaving her crying on the bed. By evening, she did not move. While she was blaming herself, Martin was driving south. As soon as his phone got a signal, he started receiving messages. He stopped and checked them. One was to say that his car was fixed and ready to be picked up. Two were from his brothers, reminding him that he should be back on Thursday. One from Curtis asked how he liked Dunfermline. Martin smiled all the way to Dunfermline to collect his car. Now he knew that she was equipped with a tracker, so there would probably be no escort. He picked up his car and paid for it to be repaired with a credit card and was told the oil pan was cracked. It almost looked like someone had done it deliberately with a jack. The mechanic told him as he transferred a suitcase and heavy bag from the Toyota Auris into his car. He then returned Auris to rentals before it closed. One of the rental employees drove him back to his car after he paid again with his credit card. Soon he was heading south again, stopping only once more at the service for a break, coffee, and to use the restroom. He arrived home a little after 10:30, stopping at the local chippy to buy fish and chips for dinner. He washed down his dinner with beer, lit a cigarette, and drank a second beer for dessert. He crumpled the paper his dinner was wrapped in and remembered her phone number. He rummaged under the chair and found it. Several missed calls from Charlotte, more from an unknown number. The number was not familiar to her phone, but was familiar to Martin. This was the number that usually called him a couple of hours before his trip to Europe, sometimes the day before. Several others were calls from her friends. There were several messages from Charlotte. Everyone asked where she was or asked to call. Several more were from other friends, all asking the same thing, and one from a number that neither her phone nor Martin recognized. It said, "Fry 19-4 guests, prepare dinner without pork." Bastard, he thought with anger. He then grinned, knowing that he had ruined those plans, and then wondered if there was any other way he could annoy Frankie, damn makeup artist. He got an idea and went to bed with a smile on his face. Angie cried from the moment Martin left until she had no tears left. Now her only companions were her regrets and despair. Martin got up at 6, an hour earlier than usual, and called at 6:30. "Hey, buddy, I hope I'm not too early," Martin said. "Hey, buddy, yes, you're a little early, 2 weeks, I think," replied the voice on the other end. "Does anyone need to be removed?" Martin smiled at his friend's joke and, as always, wondered what the reaction would be if he said yes. No, not yet, maybe soon, but at the moment I'm doing something for Angie's friends. How soon can I get some? Today, if you like, is it usual? Can I undam 2 gallons? Is it true? Is it true? Can I, when will you arrive? Tonight, maybe a little later than usual. Is that okay? Of course, see you later. Yes, buddy, see you tonight. Martin hung up and went to shower. He got out in time to stop at the hardware store on his way to work. He found what he needed and arrived at work early, was happy, and let everyone know it. "You look happy today, Martin," Curtis remarked as he entered Martin's office. "Yeah, Angie and I had a great few days. We haven't been getting along lately, but things seem to be getting better." "Thanks for asking," he said enthusiastically. "Actually, we're leaving for the weekend again tomorrow night."
That's good," Curtis said. "Did you hear from Mr. Makeup Artist this week?"
"No, why? Did he tell you something?"
No.
"It's a pity. I could take her with me. She would love to see Amsterdam or Brussels." Curtis left without making any of his usual condescending remarks. 5 minutes later, Martin's call came. "Martin, I need you to go to Brussels tomorrow morning. It's a little different. After you do a regular delivery, you have to stay over the weekend and deliver the package on Monday. I'm afraid this must be very secret, so don't take your wife with you on a dirty weekend, okay?" said the voice on the other end, not giving a chance to interrupt.
"Yes, Mr. Grimard, is the usual time and place for pickup here?" Martin asked.
"No, can you pick me up early, at 6 in the morning? They will call you with details about another task," Mr. Grace Grimard said and hung up. Martin looked at the receiver as it beeped again. Grimm's rudeness still infuriated him after all these years. "I wonder if the guests tomorrow are my bosses. In any case, no matter who they are, they will be unhappy 5 minutes after entering his house." Without hanging up, he booked a car ride on the 0915 Eurostar from Folkestone. "Then I started looking for an inexpensive B&B for a weekend stay." He left work early, at 4 o'clock, heading to a large toy store. From there, he went to Graham, a pig farmer. After finishing up business with Graham, he loaded 2 gallons of pig's blood into the trunk of his car and drove down a country road to get back to the highway. Halfway down the road, Martin's headlights revealed a car without its lights on, standing across the road. Martin was scared, sweat poured from him in streams. He approached slowly, trying to see if he could pass. There was no way. Martin peered to see if there was anyone in the car. It seemed empty. Cursing everything in the world, he put the car into reverse when suddenly his door suddenly opened. "Mr. Stein, we will meet again." Although Martin saw only a silhouette, the voice was familiar to him.
"Inspector," he exclaimed with relief. "Sorry about this whole spy game, but we noticed something the other day. There are now more bugs in your home and office than we installed," said the inspector.
"What about the car?" Martin asked.
"We checked it while it was being repaired. It has a tracker, but nothing else. By the way, what did you do with your wife?" asked the policeman.
"She is relaxing in Scotland, thinking about her mistakes. I was hoping you would send someone to find her after I, died," Martin answered.
"She has enough provisions for at least 2 weeks, possibly more than a month. She's safe where she is now."
"You're a good person, better than me," the inspector admitted. "Tomorrow you will take the A16 and E40 to Nieuwstallestraat in St. Pieters Leeuw, Belgium. Exit 18 Ruisbroek from E19. At some point you will be pulled over and there will be a tragic accident, okay?
French and Belgian names rolled off the inspector's tongue as if he were a native of both countries. Martin nodded in agreement.
I think someone will break into my house tomorrow. Could you ensure that the intruders are arrested?
For some reason, I think the break-in will happen a little after 7.
Martin asked hesitantly, adding, don't let your people come in until they hear a big bang.
It's not a problem. See you on the other side, said the inspector, returning to his car.
The inspector pulled back so that Martin could pass by. He was confident in the success of the meeting.
When Martin returned home, he took out his purchases and began preparing a surprise for his wife's guests. Then he unwound a light plastic tube. By connecting one end to the compressor in the garage, he ran it through the vent in the kitchen into the living room. He then installed a switch that would go off when the front door opened. He tested the installation several times with mock runs before adding the finishing touches and going to bed. He woke up at 5 in the morning to his alarm, got dressed, and after a cup of coffee, completed the final preparations for his plan. After double-checking that everything was in place, he kicked in the front door, breaking the lock. Propping it up from the inside, he set a trap and exited through the back door. He went to pick up the parcel. At 8:30, he stood in line to move in on the train. He took out his wife's phone and sent a message with the text, "May need to go out for half an hour," then took out the battery. 15 minutes later, he was sitting in a car in one of the Eurostar carriages. He checked that no one was looking and picked up the suitcase from the floor next to him. If he's right, it's one of 4 identical suitcases, the combinations of which he already knew from previous trips. This was what he did to kill time on long crossings. On the 3rd attempt, the locks gave in and the suitcase opened. Martin took a deep breath before opening each lock, then checked again to see if anyone was looking. Inside, he found the expected bag, took it out, and closed the suitcase. Sweating profusely, he looked around again before returning the suitcase to the floor. He waited until his hands stopped shaking before opening his purse. Sighing, he took wallet. From his jacket, he took out a small foil package. One by one, Martin moved the contents of the purse into a bag, then tied a knot and swallowed the bag. A little over an hour after he entered the train, he left it. 20 minutes later, he cleared customs and headed into Belgium along the A16. About 2 hours later, he was stopped.
Monsieur, vite, quickly.
The man with a French accent said urgently, almost dragging him out of the car and pushing him into a waiting van. Martin was thrown aside, and the van quickly drove away. He estimated that they had driven no more than 200 yards when he heard the thump of a car colliding with something heavy, and 30 seconds later, a distant explosion of fuel. Lord, long live death. The Frenchman smiled, filling the air with garlic breath. Martin's drive was uneventful except for 2 car changes, both undercover. The fellow travelers did not try to start a conversation. Just over 3 hours later, he was pushed through a door in a back street. He didn't know where he was. He was pushed towards the stairs. He climbed them obediently. At the top, there was one door that opened as soon as he approached.
"Come in, Martin," a familiar voice greeted him.
Martin was silent. He was stunned by events that have happened to him since the stop.
"You were stopped for a routine check. One of your brake lights was not working. Unfortunately, you died as a result of a collision with a truck my car steal. Your body can only be identified by DNA and dental records. It's a pity, but your wife is now a widow."
The voice was full of pride. Martin sat quietly, only now realizing that his old life was over. Everything he knew before this morning had disappeared. There was a knock on the door. A man came in, said something to the inspector, and left.
"Looks like we made it in time. The suitcase you picked up this morning was empty, nothing of value. We also learned that there was an order for you. We weren't expecting to see you back."
Martin was shocked.
"Are you saying that if you weren't already dead, you would soon be?"
The inspector confirmed. Martin's face turned pale, and he began to tremble. The inspector took the flask out of his pocket and, unscrewing the cap, handed it to Martin.
"Here, take it."
Martin sniffed and took a long sip of brandy. Warmth spread from my mouth to my chest, helping to drown out the shock of hearing the news. Inside, he was glad that they thought the suitcase was empty when he left. His devotion to Angie made him want to take her with him, but his anger wanted her to suffer. He was torn, wanting both scenarios to happen. No, in fact, he wanted none of this to happen. He eventually concluded that she would suffer as she mourned his death, perhaps blaming herself or her lover. This will be her punishment, and that should be enough. Martin was given a folder and told that this was his new life. He just looked at it. "You should learn most, if not everything, in this folder," the officer said. He then told Martin several times what would happen over the next few weeks before he was transported to his new life. Then he took out his laptop. "I thought you might want to keep an eye on your old house. It's almost 7 in the evening local time." Martin took out his wife's phone and inserted the battery. The laptop screen flickered, the inspector made a couple of clicks, and several windows appeared on the screen, each with a different view from or outside Martin's former home. A black Bentley stopped at one of the windows and 4 men got out of the car, Frank, Curtis, and 2 unknown people, black men. They headed towards the door, disappearing from the bottom of the screen. Martin clicked on the window showing his front door from the inside. He heard the doorbell and saw shadows through the glass. The door swung open and Martin heard a familiar hum, which made him smile. He heard Frank say something in an unknown language, presumably his family's native language from Senegal. He heard Curtis say, "Damn, Frank, you don't know your strength, you broke the door." "No, it's not me, man," he heard Frank answer. "This bitch should be here, she hasn't answered her phone all day. We'll make her pay for this later, let's go." Frank led them into the living room, ignoring the subtle hum coming from the garage. They entered the living room and the electronic surveillance device switched to another view. The 3 black men sat down and Curtis went to the drinks on the table. How they all failed to notice the expanding orange ball in the corner near the door will remain one of life's unsolved mysteries. Curtis noticed him first when he was carrying drinks to his African comrades. "What the?" Bang! It was a very loud explosion. Anyone outside the house would have thought it was a gunshot or an explosion. This was all Martin wanted. The balloon, already filled with 2 gallons of pig's blood, was inflated with air until it burst, covering everyone in the house and living room with the red liquid. Curtis was far from happy, but the 3 Muslims cursed every white man ever born. Martin sent a message to Frank from his wife's phone, "Pig blood." If Frank was angry before reading the message, he was furious after reading it. He screamed something unintelligible, then the door swung open again and 6 armed policemen rushed in, threw all 4 of them to the floor at gunpoint and arrested them. Both Martin and his companion laughed heartily as they watched the scene unfold on the screen. "What was it?" asked the policeman. "Pig's blood, nice touch, isn't it?" "Ha ha ha, if you weren't already dead, he would definitely kill you by now. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha, he'll think it's my wife. Ha ha ha. And I thought you let her go too easily. Ha ha ha." The thought pierced Martin like a knife. If Frank thinks Angie is guilty, he will do anything to get revenge. She is as dead as he is. This realization darkened his mood, and he lost the desire to laugh. "I didn't think this through. I don't want her to get hurt." His voice was almost pleading as he realized the possible consequences of his joke. "It doesn't matter. There's nothing we can do to help her," the inspector said. "We can't or don't want to?" Martin asked, staring at him with a cold gaze. "I may not be able to testify." The look he received in response made it clear to Martin that he had no leverage at the moment. The reality that both he and his wife were imprisoned, albeit for their protection, but imprisoned nonetheless, dawned on him. Several 100 miles away, Angie was busy thinking, writing, crossing out, revising, and rewriting her confession. "To my dear husband, I'm sorry for what I did to Frank, makeup artist, and with you. I cannot express how much I am sorry and how I can ask you to forgive me. As you probably already guessed, this is all because of Charlotte. About 1 year ago, while you were away, Charlotte told me that she was on a double date with Marie and Frank and another man. She said that Marie would not be able to come and asked me to replace her. I said no, but she assured me that nothing sexual would happen, and like a fool, I believed her. The date was dinner and dancing, and I ended up paired with Frank. I don't know how we ended up from the club in his bed. I've been trying to figure it out for weeks after the first time and again since you left me here. All I know is that I can't explain it. I have to admit, I found him attractive from the first moment I saw him. There's something to it. I can't explain it, but even you have to admit that he has strong charisma, but he was too difficult to refuse. I felt guilty for betraying you. The next time you were away, Charlotte said he wanted to see me again. I told her no, honestly. You have to believe me. He came to us late at night, without invitation. I didn't want to let him in. He said he just wanted to talk about what happened last time, so I invited him over for a drink and to talk. Just talk, honestly. That was the only reason I let him in. I shouldn't have done this. Maybe we could have saved our relationship. This was the first night I allowed him to do this at home, the first night he desecrated our marital bed. When he left, I cried myself to sleep. The next time you were away, the same thing happened. I wish I could say I wished it was you, but by then I was in love with him. Now that I'm faced with my lust, my lack of respect, and the way I treated you like a pet, I realize that I couldn't feel more sorry for what I did to him. I'm sorry, my beloved, but being in love does not describe what I felt, the desires that he awakened in me. I'm sorry, my love, but for a while I was fascinated by this idea. Together we came up with disgusting things that I did with your food, and I'm very ashamed, but I guess it was my idea. I'm sorry, but I was just carried away by him, fascinated by his strength, his power. I am now rereading what I wrote, and I am even more disgusted with myself than before. I understand that there is no way that you can forgive me for what I did to you. How can you forgive me if I cannot forgive myself? I have no right to ask you for forgiveness, and you should not even consider such a possibility. If there is hell, I will burn in it forever. Goodbye, my love. Angie. She folded the paper and put it on the table, covering it with her purse. For a week, Martin kept himself in a small apartment, eating ready-made meals, spending his time either questioning his knowledge of Grimm's business or preparing for his new trial and new life as Eric Williams. Almost every day he had to rinse and swallow that valuable sachet. A week later, he was moved to a more comfortable and secluded location, and when he was settled, Gray visited him. Eric immediately realized that something was wrong as soon as Gray entered the cottage. His two guards left. Gray looked at him, sadness in his eyes. "Martin, Eric, I have news, and it's not good. We sent someone to pick up your wife. There's no easy way to say it. She took her own life." Eric fell to the floor in shock and began to cry. Gray looked at him, feeling helpless. He wanted to say something, but there were no words. The only thing that came to mind was the standard and insincere "sorry for your loss," which is often heard in American crime series. In the end, he managed to say, "You shouldn't blame yourself." Eric looked up at him, his face red with anger. "Blame yourself? Why do you think I'll do this? I blame that damn bastard and that cheater I married. Blaming myself is not my plan. Honestly, in a way I'm glad, but that doesn't mean I'm not sorry. Damn, I've loved that bitch for a long time." Gray studied him and, taking a flask from his pocket, handed it to Eric. "I have two more bottles in the car." "Damn it, you probably stole them from me. Bring them here, I need a drink." Eric snapped. "Eric, there was a note for you. I have a copy of it. I think you want to read it. I'm not sure it will help." Gray took out a folded piece of paper from his jacket and handed it to Eric. Eric looked at the paper, weighing whether he wanted to read her last goodbye. He nodded, more to himself than to the inspector, before taking it from the outstretched hand. Gray watched him as he opened the letter, then left it so he could read it in private. He stopped at the door and looked at him before getting out and going to get his drink in the car. "Damn cow, bitch did this to me and took the easy way out. Now I regret not leaving her suffer." These were his words, but inside he regretted them. He regretted leaving her there alone. He regretted being in a situation that allowed her to become such an easy target. He regretted the whole situation, but most of all, he now regretted that he would never be able to hold her again. He and Gray got drunk together. Eric talked about his life as Martin, about early happy days with Angie. Gray finally said his name. Eric's mood was constantly changing. At one point, he became so gloomy that Gray began to fear whether he could win him back. Then he remembered that, as far as he knew, no one had yet told Eric about the consequences of his trap. You know, that surprise you left for good old Francois and his friends. Gray said he was rewarded with a smile on the tear-stained face in front of him. Well, these Muslims don't like anything to do with pigs, harem, I think it's called. These two guys from Senegal are quite religious, and it's a bit of a tough question whether we allowed them to shower. Some might say we told them we wouldn't let them shower unless they spoke. Others might say we offered them a shower if they spoke. The official version says that they happily spoke without lawyers and sang like nightingales. We should be able to put Mr. Makeup artists up for a long time based on their confessions. Brother Skisik were also very helpful. You probably won't even have to testify. He let the words sink in. This gave us grounds to obtain warrants to search their premises and his. It seems your bosses are Brother Skisik, had coded books, and Mr. Francois Grimard had the key. Between them, we were able to access all of his records. Many people will go to trial. Your little act of revenge has paid off. You have helped us more than we could have ever dreamed of. Eric smiled at the news. He wasn't looking forward to going to court and letting Frank know he was alive. I'm angry, angry about what he did, what she did, and the whole damn rotten situation. Eric burst out. I'm angry that she can't be punished for what she did. For what she did to me. I'm angry that she's dead and angry that she's not here with me and I'm dead. What the hell am I supposed to do now? A dead man has no friends, no family, no one. I'm completely alone. He sobbed, tears flowing in streams again. Gray looked at him, feeling helpless, inadequate, and useless. He felt his eyes fill with tears of sympathy. You'll get support, he offered, realizing how trite that sounded. Wow, that's it. Well, then it's all right, isn't it? Eric answered sarcastically. Inspector Gray said nothing. He knew he had said too much, probably because he had drunk too much. He looked at the bottles. One was empty. The other was almost empty. It's your fault she's dead. You brought me into this, he shouted. Gray said something to the guards in French, and, putting Eric back in his chair, they returned to their seats. Sorry, I shouldn't have blamed you, Eric said, gaining clarity. It's okay, I understand. The last few weeks couldn't have been easy, Gray said sincerely. He could not imagine how this poor man felt. He knew the facts, but knowing the facts could not explain the confusion of emotions he had to go through. How about we finish this and go to bed? Gray suggested. Eric said nothing and, finding an overturned glass on the floor, handed it to Gray. Gray poured him a large portion, then emptied the bottle into his glass, picking it up and saying, "Here's to a new and better life." "To a new life," Eric replied, raising his glass. Martin's funeral was quiet, with only a few mourners present. Angie's was even more depressing. Even her friend Charlotte didn't bother to attend. Eric wanted to, but he was not advised. Eric Williams settled in Gloucester on the Saturday after the funeral and started working as a data entry operator just over a week later. Francois Grimard was sentenced to 80 years for each of the crimes. All sentences were set consecutively. He will no longer see freedom. Curtis received a total of 70 years. Charles received 47. Many of Grimm's employees were convicted. Most were detained with sentences ranging from 2 to 18 years. Charlotte received 5 years for pimping and living off illegal proceeds. Eric worked as a data entry operator until he was sure he wasn't being watched by Interpol or the British police. He remained on guard until he was sure that he had not been monitored for more than a year. Taking a 2-week vacation, he traveled around Europe for unknown reasons, stopping in Brussels only for a few hours. A few months later, he retired and moved to the Algarve. If anyone ever asked him about his wealth, his story would be that he was a good investor. Subscribe to our channel so that your second chaff doesn't cheat on you, and go ahead and listen to the next story, because this story is nothing compared to the next one. If you're under 18, don't even think about listening to the next one.